Hello, everyone, and welcome to DeveloperWorks Live and another live coding event. I'm your host, Scott Lanningham. I'm a producer here at DeveloperWorks TV. Our topic today is Introduction to Neural Networks and Deep Learning Using Standalone Python or Keras plus TensorFlow. Now, before we meet our speaker, just a couple quick things to go over. After the event, you'll receive an email with a link to a replay page, which will have the embed code and the player from the replay of this event. You can watch it again and share it with others, and there'll be additional resource links on that page to help you get started yourself. You'll get an email, but if you want that link now, you can write it down. It's ibm.biz/DWLive011. And again, the replay should be up on that page within just a few hours after the show ends today. If you have questions for our speaker, please use the Q&A feature. And you zoom over the player, you'll see that button near the top of the conference window. There's also a chat feature, and you're welcome to use that to chat among yourselves or to give us comments. But if you want to submit questions to the speaker, please use the Q&A feature. So let's meet our speaker. Romeo Kinsler is a senior data scientist and deep learning and AI engineer for IBM Watson IoT and an IBM certified senior architect. Welcome, Romeo.
Hi, Scott. How are you doing?
Very good. Good to have you back. Let me ask a couple of questions just to kick this off at the top, if that's okay. Well, what are the trade-offs between using deep learning frameworks like TensorFlow or PyTorch versus building a neural network from scratch? What would you say about that?
So I think it's a two-step process in your learning. So in a productive use case, I wouldn't recommend at all to do it on your own from scratch. But on the other way around, if you want to really understand what deep learning is and what's going on, then you have to implement it from scratch. And that's actually what I want to teach you today. So first of all, we will implement a deep learning neural network from scratch and train it. And after you have understood how that works, we will use a framework like Keras and TensorFlow in order to make things faster.
I hear you. Makes total sense. Want to have that strong foundation before you get going. Is there anything else that you want to tell us about this use case you'll be coding today before you get started?
I can jump in. I will later, when I come to Keras and TensorFlow, explain where I have using this framework and what data it's analyzing.
Okay, Romeo, the floor is all yours. Take it away.
Okay, so let me share my screen. So do you see that slide?
Yeah, it looks great.
Perfect. Okay. So the first thing I want to do is to give you an introduction about machine learning at all. So some of you might not really know what's going on here. So machine learning is basically teaching an algorithm to transform your data in a way that you can make user sense of it. And there are two flavors of machine learning. One is called unsupervised machine learning, and one is called supervised machine learning. So unsupervised machine learning actually only transforms your data in a way that you understand it better. So that can, for example, remove columns from a table which are irrelevant or visualize it in a way that you get the point. An example for that is clustering. On the other hand, you have supervised machine learning, and that means you are training an algorithm with already labeled data, okay? And here, it's an example where you want to predict the values on the y-axis based on values on the x-axis. And you can see here, it's a linear data set. So the blue dots are actual examples of data points, and you want to create a predictor. So if you don't have a data point for a specific value on the x-axis, your model, your machine learning model, should predict what's on the y-axis. So the hello world example in supervised machine learning is called linear regression. It is called regression because you want to predict the continuous value. And that brings me to the two flavors in supervised machine learning. You have regression, where you want to predict the continuous value, or you have classification, where you want to predict a category. And in that, you have binary classification, Yeah, you have only two categories, or you have multi-class classification. Yeah, you have multiple categories. So let me show how this model looks like. You have yi, which is the predicted value on the y-axis, and you have a couple of x parameters. So this formula doesn't really fit to this chart because this is a one-dimensional chart. That means you have one dimension of x where you want to predict a one dimension of y. But you can use as many columns or features or parameters, data scientists tend to use those words interchangeably, to predict your y outcome. In this case, you have x1 and it goes up to xp. The famous example is predicting house prices from the number of square meters of the house and on the ground and the number of rooms. That means you have three dimensions, the size of the house, the size of the ground, and the number of rooms, and you want to predict the house price. In order to achieve that, you can use this formula here, and you train the parameters beta, beta 1 to beta p, and then you get a linear combination, and that linear combination is your Hello World linear regression machine learning model. In order to turn this into a classifier, a binary classifier, you just take the output of your linear regression model and use a function, in this case it's called sigmoid. This function squashes the complete value range from minus infinity to plus infinity to a range between 0 and 1. Then you just define a threshold in between and you get a binary classifier. So why am I telling you all that? The reason is a neural network is basically nothing else than a set of logistic regression models which are stacked. So if you turn a linear regression model into a binary classifier, you get logistic regression. And you get that by using the sigmoid function on your outputs. In a neural network, you're doing the same. You're basically calculating linear regression. Then you apply a so-called activation function which can be sigmoid, and then you continue to stack those models on top. So here's an example. You have here a two-dimensional input of x, then you multiply it with a weight, and then you add all the individual values up, and you get here the value for the hidden layer neuron. So that's set 2. It's x times w. Don't be confused with that notation here. This is vector matrix multiplication. That means you take each individual value of each vector and multiply it, and then you sum up the result. This is a way how to compute a complete layer of a neural network within just one multiplication. And on the other hand, vector matrix and matrix-matrix multiplication, they can be accelerated using graphic cards. So that's really handy. So you calculate C2 from X and W. X is your input data, W are the parameters, your neural network. And then what you do is you call a function on set 2, and what you get is this A2. So A2 is called the activation of the first layer, first hidden layer. And f can be, for example, sigmoid. Then you take A2, and as I said, neural networks is nothing else than multiple layers of stacked logistic regression models. You take the output A2 as input to the next model. So look at equation 1 and 3. They are basically the same, with the only difference that the input equation 3 is A2 instead of x. But it's the same. You're also computing this vector matrix multiplication here, you get set 3, and then again, you squash it using sigmoid or any other activation function, and you get y hat. And y hat is interesting because y hat is your predicted value for y. That means you have an actual value of y and a predicted value of y. And this predicted value of y is only based on this computation here. And this computation here is only dependent on the weights W1 and W2. So you train this neural network by adjusting weights 1 and weights 2 until y hat is something similar to y. And you can calculate the error, that means how good your neural network is doing, based on the values of y. That means you have here this equation j, which takes two parameters, w and t. T is the training set. T is your training data, basically the values of x. So you can basically leave out t out of that equation because that's constant. You're always training with the same data. So this function is only dependent on w. And you see here a two-dimensional case for w, w1 and w2. So it depends how you choose w1 and w2, and you get a certain error. If you are choosing the values w1 and w2 correctly, you end up with a low error. If you choose it incorrectly, then you end up with a high error. And this whole surface here is called the error gradient. And now let's actually calculate how we can train such a neural network. So in order to train a neural network, we use an algorithm called backpropagation, which calculates the value y hat here, and then it subtracts y from y hat, and that's the error. And what we do is we just compute all computations in reverse. That means this error backpropagates based on that weights here to the middle layer and also back to the input layer. And we do one step in addition. We not only calculate the neural network backwards, we take the first derivative of that computation and we take the first partial derivative with respect to a single weight dimension. And that gives us a so-called gradient, a gradient into the direction of the steepest descent of this cost function. So let's start with an example. Let's take w1 and w2 randomly and do the computation. Then we end up at a random point at this cost surface. This is a cost surface because it's two-dimensional, but in actual neural network training, the surface is a high-dimensional space, and you're basically, it's impossible to visualize that. So from that point, we do one backpropagation step and calculate the gradient into the direction of the steepest descent. And then we update W1 and W2 based on that, and we redo the calculation. So we end up with a lower value. And again, and again, and again. So in this case, this algorithm, by the way, is called gradient descent. And the cool thing about gradient descent, it can be run on a cluster. So if your single machine doesn't have enough resources to compute it, you can easily run it on a cluster. So this is guaranteed to find the optimal value because this surface here is convex. That means it has only one single global minima. But the catch is in neural networks, the cost functions are non-convex, so they have a lot of local optima, but still gradient descent can be tuned to get feasible solutions here. So that was a bit of theory. Now let's start some practice. I'm using a tool called Data Science Experience. It's datascience.ibm.com. which in the open source parts is nothing else than Jupyter Notebooks and an Apache Spark service. So we give this a name. We choose here Python as a programming language, and we choose Spark version 1.2 as executor. But in this case, we don't use Apache Spark so far. If you want to know how to train and score neural networks on Apache Spark, please refer to my last week's talk. It's already recorded. I've shown you how to do it using Deep Learning for J and SystemML. So let's actually start with a neural network. So let's define a neural network class in Python. So we always start with importing NumPy. NumPy is the central thing we need. And then we call this class neural network. And then we define a constructor. So in the constructor, we put one variable called input layer size. So we have two neurons in the input layer. And we say output size, we have one. And then we define a hidden layer, which is three. Now we have to define the weights. So there's weight one for the first layer. And we use numpy.random and we create some random numbers. And this is a matrix, so a 2D array. And one dimension is the input layer size. And one dimension is the hidden layer size, okay? So then we need a second weight matrix. And again, it's np.random.rand(n). And then, as you might be guessing, it's hidden layer size. It's one dimension, and the other one is output layer size. And that's it. So we have basically defined all the parameters we need for initialization of this neural network. So one thing we need to do is we have to define a forward computation. That's pretty straightforward. So it takes x as an input. And then we calculate z2. Let's go back to the slides. Just to remember. First of all, we create z2 based on x and w1. So let's do that. So z2 equals np. So np dot dot, this is the function for vector matrix and matrix multiplication. So we multiply x with the first weight matrix w1. And now we have to compute a2. So remember, a2 is just the activation function applied to z2. So this is self.sigmoid self.c2. So you might notice that we don't have a function sigmoid here. So let's implement sigmoid. It's pretty straightforward. It's sigmoid, which takes x, or c in this case. Maybe better we define it as c. And then it's pretty straightforward. We say return, and it's 1/1 plus -c. So if you are confused, just search for sigmoid in Google and go to Wikipedia, and you see here this definition of sigmoid. So the same thing we are doing here in Python, NumPy. So let's see if that's all correct. Yeah, seems to be okay. So now we can calculate a2, so that's self sigmoid self z2. Now let's go on. Now we have to calculate c3. Remember, c3 is a2 times w2. That's again np dot self a2 self w2. And again, we have to calculate a3, but a3 is the same as y hat, because that's the actual predicted output. So that's self sigmoid self c3. So that's our forward function. And now what we have to do is we have to calculate this backwards. Correct this here. And let me just write that down. We call this cost function. And this is dependent on X and on Y because we are comparing. So we are using the weight matrices we apply to X, we get Y hat, and we are comparing it against Y hat, against Y. Therefore, we have to pass Y as well. And we say self.y hat equals self.forward. So we do a forward path, and then we compute the cost. So that's just, I write it down. It's a bit of linear algebra and calculus, but just trust me, it is this one. And now we have to calculate sigmoid prime. That's also the reverse function of sigmoid. So the sigmoid prime, so C. And we can also use NumPy here, NumPy exp minus C, and divided by 1 plus NP dot exp minus C, and all that stuff goes into another bracket, which is then squared. So now what we have to do is we have to compute the cost function prime, okay? So that's the first derivative, cost function prime, self x, y, and self y hat equals self forward. That's the same as before. And now it gets interesting. So we are calculating delta 3. It's multiply minus y minus self y hat. We multiply it by self sigmoid prime self set free. So let me double check if that is correct. It's n by multiply, and in the brackets with minus y minus self y hat, comma self sigmoid prime. So that seems to be okay. So if we go back to the slides, so we have been calculating here delta 3, and delta 3 is the errors in that middle layer. That's here delta 3. That's minus y hat multiplied by the first derivative of the activation function, which is sigmoid. And here we have just used sigmoid prime, because sigmoid prime is the first derivative of the sigmoid function. So from here, let's actually calculate the gradient. That's dj dw2. It's also defined here. dj dw2. And that's the dot product again. So the matrix multiplication of self A2. And we take the transpose. That's because we are using the first derivative. That's some linear algebra things going on here, but don't be scared about those. And then say NP dot, and we do the same delta 3 self W2 transpose times self sigmoid prime self C2. And then it's dj dw1 equals the dot product of x transpose, again x transpose because of some linear algebra magic, because that's the first derivative, delta 2. If we are lucky, most likely we are not, this is also already correct. At least it compiles. So let's see how it's going on. Maybe we have to fix it later. But now we create some test data. We will use x and we create an array or a matrix. And this matrix is, first of all, that shape. So we have 3.5, and then we have 5.1, and we have 10.2. And then we say it's of data type float. And then we create y. So that's our target. So that's, we want to predict y based on x, and we give this some training data. So what we do is we create another NumPy array. It's also a matrix. Oh, sorry, that's a vector. So which is 75 and 82 and 93. And it's also of type float. Put it here. So let's see how this looks like. This data. So that's a 3x2 matrix, and that's a 3x1 matrix. So that's actually three examples, and the x has two dimensions. As we see here, we have two neurons for x, and y has one dimension. We have one for y. So in order to get a bit more test data, we can also use some random initialization. So we say np.random, and we create 10,000 of these examples. And we create also y. We say this one here. So we actually calculate y based on x and then try to learn that function we are using. So let me just implement this and explain it to you. So this is functional programming, which means we are summing up that two-dimensional matrix. That means y is just the sum of both. So if you now have a look at y, x, this is this two-dimensional matrix. If you have a look at y, this is that one-dimensional. And let's see it again. So we have the first element is 0.5, and here's the first element 0.4 something. So we would expect to have 0.9 something. Not really. Ah, sorry. No, no, we have 0.53 and we have 0.59, and we add this up, we get 1 dot something here. Yeah, okay, that's correct. So again, let's print the shape here. So it's 10,000 by 2 and 10,000 by 1. So that's our training data. Now let's actually create a neural network and let us train it. So define the neural network. So we instantiate a neural network. And say max iteration 3. Let's use 10,000. And let's initialize this counter. So now there comes one important thing, the learning rate. I will explain you later why we define this. And now we are implementing gradient descent by hand. Okay? That means once we are below max iterations, so 10,000 times, we will do the following. First of all, we want to get our gradients djdw1 and djdw2. Jeez, let's put that in capital to be consistent. So that's our cost function prime based on x and y. So if we call this the first time, we get a huge error because we initialize w1 and w2 randomly. But we will update it. So we say neural network w1 equals neural network w1 minus djdw1. But if we do that like this, that means we might shoot over. I'll explain you what I mean by that. So if we calculate the gradient, we want to do tiny steps. We don't want to shoot to some point. This makes sense. If we have a non-convex cost function, then we might shoot over a local minima. Therefore, we are doing tiny steps. So that means we are multiplying by the learning rate, which is 0.01. Oh, this is getting reddish. Let me disable that. So, and the same thing we do, of course, for the gradient of the second grade matrix. So we have updated that. And that's basically all. It's really cool. Gradient descent is nothing more than that. But we want to get some feedback. So if this iteration hits a divisor of 1,000, that means every 1,000 iterations we print the cost function. And that's the only reason I've implemented the forward direction of the cost function. And now let's see what happens. Of course, we get some errors. Cost function prime, there's no cost function prime. Yeah, there was a typo, so run it again. What else? Self W not defined. This is maybe here or somewhere. Self. Where's that? Ah, okay, it's here. Self cost function prime. We have here typo. Where's self W? I don't find it. Ah, here. Self. Yeah, point is missing. And what else? Self W2 is also not defined. That's also in cost function prime. Cost function prime. Self. Oh, self W2, of course. So, and what else? No, I'm not getting it. So it's before Y hat. Ah, here it is. Okay, let's see. And what else? Module object has no attribute multiply. So let me double check the problem there. Where's that multiply, cost function prime, np multiply. That's strange. Give me 1 second. Delta 3 NP multiply. I'm not understanding that. NP multiply. NP. So in my opinion, that's correct. It's the one thing just For that, I have just created a cheat sheet. So I will just copy paste the working version of cost function prime. So and test not with cost function prime. I don't believe that. Maybe it's some other typo. And then it should work. Okay. What else? Yeah, that's the live coding thing. If you do one typo, then you are basically doomed.
So everybody knows we are truly live, right?
Yeah. We are live. And we are fixing this, of course, also live. I provide you with the working version, I promise, later. So, so this version is even better because you cannot only use sigmoid as activation function. You can also use tanh and implemented some other. Let's see, tanh and logistic. And now let's see what I have messed up. I think I've messed up a lot. So this is not an issue. Oh, you know what? Let me just do one thing. Let me run this and this and this and this. You see, now it's working. I could fix it, but it would take me another 10 minutes, maybe. So what happens now is I'm training the neural network. This is gradient descent. And here you see the error. So that means we are training it and the error goes down. I'm doing 10,000 iterations. Every 1,000 iterations, I'm printing the error. And you can also see the error is maybe also going up. That's because the cost function is not here ideal with one global optima, which is a convex function. The cost function of neural networks are non-convex. So it's like a ball rolling down the Himalaya. And if you are having a bad time, your ball gets stuck into some local optima. That means at a high point in the Himalayas. And really the art of neural network training is to find a configuration where this ball somehow rolls fast enough downhill that you find a good valley, but it's not so fast that it, after passing the valley, it rolls uphill. But you see here, it's doing a pretty nice job. So it's after 10,000 iterations, it has converge to some local optimizer, not the best one, but for illustrating this, it's enough. So if we now print y, that's the actual value we are expecting. And if we print neural network.forward, this is the trained version of the neural network, then we get here the predicted value. You see here, it should be 1.4, we get 0.99. It should be 0.21, we get 0.1. It's not doing the best job, but it's better than random. So let's actually use this function. This function is called SSE. SSE stands for sum of squared errors. So let's actually Google for that. Just take an image on a formula function. Formula. So, for example, here. So, the sum of squared errors is nothing else than taking each value of the actual value subtract the predicted value, take the square of it, and sum it all up. Okay, so that's what I'm doing here. So that's functional programming style again here. So we have our y, and we have our y hat. Then we use the zip function of Python, that's functional programming, to create a list of tuples. And then we create the map. We use the map function to iterate over each of those tuples. So that's A and B. And then you see here, we just subtract A from B and we square it. And that's basically what you see here. And then we just sum it up. The sum symbol here, that's the sum here. And that's a function we are defining here. And then we print the sum of squared errors. So we get around 0.08. That's actually a good value because on an average, we are predicting the value and it's just by 0.089 off, okay? So if we now run this cell here, so we re-instantiate a neural network, that means we set the weight matrices to random values again, and we can calculate the error, then you see here we are off by 0.5. Okay, that's actually proof that it's really working. So as you have seen, neural network definition and training in pure Python is a nightmare. I even had a problem by copying already a working version to a new notebook. Therefore, exist tons and tons of libraries. Just to name a few, there is TensorFlow, there's PyTorch, there's Deep Learning for J, there's Caffe, there's SystemML, and so on and so on. And I personally, I prefer high-level libraries. And one very famous high-level library is Keras. So Keras is able to use different neural network libraries in the background, either TensorFlow, so let me just run this here, and it tells me only in the first call that it uses TensorFlow as a backend. You can also use Deep Learning for J or Apache SystemML or other libraries as a backend. So what I'm doing here is, so this is a real example which we have implemented this weekend at the CodeIoT Hackathon in Munich. And some team actually wanted to predict vibration sensor data, which we have captured through a Texas Instruments sensor tag. And using the IBM Watson IoT platform, we have streamed this data into a NoSQL database called Cloudant, which is backed by Apache CouchDB. And that's just the X vibration, which I am getting here. And I'm doing some sort of data transformation. So this is a time series. And in order to train on time series, I'm transforming the data in the following way. For each value, I'm also taking the past 10 and the future 10 values into account. So see here, t minus 10, t minus 9, and so on. And also at the bottom, you will see t plus 8, t plus 9. Okay, so that's just the window of 20 values. And that I'm using to train. And here is my Keras code. So, and Keras is really cool because all you have to do is you start with a model. I'm here using a so-called sequential model. If you are interested in sequential models for time series analytics, just watch my live session from last week, recording. I've explained how those work. But the idea is you don't have only simple neurons like you have here. You have smart neurons which have memory, and those are called LSTM. LSTM stands for long short-term memory network. So I'm just defining one layer of such smart neurons which have memory, and then a so-called dense layer, which then is a normal feed-forward layer. And again, I see here the iterations. Now I'm using TensorFlow as a backend. And I see here also my error is going down. Now let's plot what's happening. And you see here, the blue line is the actual value and the green line is the predicted. You might think that's not so nice, but you see the patterns are learned by the neural network. So I am personally really proud of that. So you see here, when nothing is going on, the neural network predicts nothing is going on. If you get a lot of vibration, it predicts vibration. And even within such a set of vibration, you are approximating the overall shape of the vibration. I just need to tweak this neural network a bit that the scale is better. But apart from that, I'm pretty happy with that. And again, here, this is a plot how this neural network is converging against a local optima. And it's always a good idea to make a plot of your training error, which should go down during training, and it should approximate and converge to some low value. Okay, so I'm done. Yeah, and I will put a link. So we will put a link to this notebooks for your download, and you can actually do it yourself. So it's a great thing to learn how neural networks work. And I can recommend you one thing. If you get, you get also my slides. And in that slides, there is a link, maybe you have seen it before, to a YouTube playlist. And that's awesome. So that's called Neural Networks Demystified. It's a playlist of 7 videos. And I had to watch those 7 videos 7 times each. And those are all around 7 minutes. So it's 7 times 7 times 7. And after you have done that, you actually know how that stuff works.
So Romy, I didn't even think to ask you, where do you want to direct people if they want to interact with you, ask you questions, chat with you?
I'm everywhere. Just Google for my name. I'm on YouTube. I'm on Twitter. I'm on LinkedIn, Xing, Google+, Facebook. Feel free to use any of those channels.
Okay, you heard it. Romeo is omnipresent.
One or two additions. Okay. So I've created a little web page for all of you because I'm talking a lot at conferences and everybody asks me, how can I get into that very easily? And I end up sending links to them. So I've created a little web page. It's called nopanic.ai. And you can basically just follow level 1, 2, and 3. And I've put a lot of links to training materials, external, free. And the other thing is we are currently in the process of creating a specialization on Coursera. So at the moment, we are creating a course called Applied Artificial Intelligence Using Deep Learning on Apache Spark, which will be live on 17th of December. And at the end, in February 2018, there are then 3 courses, and you will get a certificate called IBM Certified Data Scientist if you do all that. So stay tuned for our course and have a lot of fun.
So that wraps up our broadcast for today. A thank you again to Romeo Kinsler for his great presentation. I'm Scott Lanningham again with DeveloperWorks TV. You can follow the replay. You can see the replay and enjoy the resource links around this topic today at ibm.biz/DWLive011. And you will be getting that in an email if you watched with us today. Keep your eye on developer.ibm.com/TV for more live coding events and other videos from DeveloperWorks TV. We appreciate your time. See you again soon.